Welcome to the FixSleep Bedtime Stories Channel, your sanctuary for relaxation, meditation, and a peaceful sleep. Immerse yourself in the soothing embrace of sleep-inducing tales, carefully crafted to transport you to mysterious lands. Let the gentle rain and serene sounds of nature accompany you on this journey to relaxation. Say goodbye to restless nights and welcome the embrace of a restful sleep with our magical sleep stories. So, let the tale begin. Elven Secrets, The Lost Water. Chapter 1, The Dried Up Spring. In the mystical village of Elfland, nestled between lush green hills and whispering forests, there lived an elf named Caleth. His life was tranquil, a gentle rhythm of peaceful days spent amidst nature's bounty. Caleth, like his kin, had a deep connection with the natural world. His hands skilled in crafting potent potions from morning dewdrops, and his mind adept at weaving subtle enchantments with fallen leaves and fragrant herbs. Each morning, Caleth would wander through the dew-laden meadows, collecting droplets that glimmered like tiny stars caught in the dawn's early light. These he used in his potions, which healed minor ailments and soothed the weary spirits of his fellow villagers. In the afternoons, he practiced his enchantments, often sitting beneath the ancient whispering oak, whose leaves murmured secrets only the pure of heart could decipher. However, this tranquility was disrupted one crisp morning when Caleth made a troubling discovery. The spring that supplied water to their village, a sparkling fountain that bubbled up at the forest's edge, had mysteriously dried up. The moss around its stone rim was cracked and dry, and where once clear water flowed, now lay only pebbles and dust. Alarmed, Caleth reported his findings to the village council. The elders, wise and venerable beings cloaked in robes of woven silver moonlight, were deeply concerned. Water was the lifeblood of Elfland, essential not only for drinking, but for nourishing the enchanted plants and creatures that thrived in their magical habitat. Determined to resolve this crisis, Caleth turned to the ancient scrolls kept in the heart of the Elder Tree, a sacred repository of elfin knowledge and history. These scrolls were written in the silver script, a language of light and shadow that danced on the parchment, visible only under the moon's gentle gaze. Under the silvery light of a full moon, Caleth deciphered the texts, his fingers tracing the luminescent characters that told of the hidden delta, an oasis of incredible power and beauty said to contain the heart of the water spirit. Legend had it that this spirit possessed the ability to summon water from the depths of the earth and bless it with properties that could sustain and enrich life. With the knowledge gleaned from the scrolls, Caleth felt a surge of determination. He understood that finding the hidden delta might be the only way to save his village. The journey would be perilous, fraught with unknown dangers and trials. But the thought of his village, his home, lying barren and lifeless, spurred him into action. Before dawn broke the next day, Caleth stood before the village council, seeking their blessing for his quest. The elders, with solemn expressions and eyes glinting with ancient wisdom, laid their hands upon him. They chanted blessings in the ancient tongue, their voices rising and falling like the gentle flow of a river, weaving protective magics around him. "Go with the grace of the forest, with the swiftness of the river, and with the strength of the earth," intoned the High Elder, her voice resonant with the power of their ancestral magic. Armed with only his wit, a satchel of essential potions, and the blessings of his people, Caleth set out at first light. He traveled light, carrying only what was necessary, for speed was essential. His path first led him through the fisherman's village at the edge of the Whispering Woods, where he hoped to gather more information about the recent changes in the water's flow. As Caleth ventured forth, the sun rose, casting beams of light through the dense canopy of the forest, illuminating his path with patches of golden light. Birds sang from hidden perches, and the wind carried the scent of wildflowers, which bloomed profusely along the ancient forest trail. Though his heart was heavy with the responsibility he carried, Caleth's spirit was buoyed by the beauty of the world around him and the vital importance of his quest to not only his village, but to all who called the forest their home. Chapter 2. Through the Fisherman's Village. As Caleth approached the fisherman's village, the path narrowed and wound its way along the bank of a meandering river. This was where the vital waters that once fed the now dry spring originated. The village itself was cradled by the river's embrace, its cottages dotting the lush landscape like scattered pearls on a verdant tapestry. Smoke curled from chimneys and mingled with the mist rising off the river in the early morning chill. Upon entering the village, Caleth was struck by the lively atmosphere. Fishermen and their families bustled about, mending nets, bartering fish, and preparing their boats for a day on the water. Children played on the docks, their laughter mingling with the calls of the river birds. However, despite this facade of normalcy, a palpable undercurrent of concern was evident. The furrowed brows and anxious glances cast toward the river did not escape Caleth's observant eyes. Approaching the water's edge, Caleth saw that the river, which should have been robust with the early spring runoff, was sluggish and worryingly low. Mudflats that should have been submerged were exposed and cracked, and boats sat awkwardly tilted in the insufficient water. Caleth spent his first day in quiet observation, aiding where he could, his presence slowly becoming accepted. It was on his second day in the village that he met old Bren, a weathered fisherman with eyes like the deep sea, who seemed to hold the respect of the entire village. Over a shared meal of smoked fish and wild rice, Bren spoke of the river's plight. "They say the river speaks, Elf," Bren began, his voice rough as gravel, but imbued with a rhythmic cadence that reminded Caleth of waves lapping against a shore. "Lately, it whispers of shadows, of a darkness that clings to its waters like oil to a bird's feathers. We fear something has tampered with its essence." Caleth listened intently, his mind racing. This aligned with the dire changes he had noticed and the legends he had read. Determined to earn the trust of these folk and gather their aid, Caleth offered his skills as an enchanter of the natural world. The next morning, Caleth rose with the sun and joined the fishermen by the riverside. With a gentle tone, he explained the nature of his magic and its harmony with the elements. Skeptical but desperate, the villagers watched as Caleth approached the first of the worn-out fishing nets. He sang an old elvish chant, his voice soft but clear. The threads of the net shimmered lightly, as if dusted with morning dew, restored to a strength that belied their age. Word of his deeds spread quickly, and soon, Caleth was teaching the villagers minor water charms. He showed them how to imbue their buckets with a charm to keep the catch fresh, and taught the children small spells to make the water ripple, much to their delight. Gratitude warmed the villagers toward him, replacing initial suspicion with burgeoning respect and admiration. On the eve of his departure, the village gathered to offer their thanks. Old Bren, with the village elders beside him, presented Caleth with a sturdy boat outfitted for his journey. "This boat is named Whisper," Bren declared, patting the vessel's polished side. "She'll carry your whispers to the heart of the deep forest, where perhaps you'll find answers to heal our river." The boat was equipped with provisions and detailed maps of the river's winding paths through the deep forest. Caleth was touched by their generosity and resolved to not only find a new source of water, but to discover the cause of the river's ailment and remedy it if he could. As he set off the following dawn, the villagers lined the riverbank, waving and shouting their blessings. With a heart both heavy and hopeful, Caleth steered the Whisper into the river's current. His journey into the unknown, powered by the strength of newfound allies and the urgent need to restore balance to the natural world. Chapter 3, The Deep Forest. As Caleth steered the Whisper deeper into the heart of the deep forest, the river's meandering waters grew darker, reflecting the dense canopy above. The trees stood like ancient sentinels, their massive trunks covered in layers of moss and lichen, and their branches weaving a thick tapestry of leaves that barely let through any sunlight. The air was thick with the scent of earth and decay, a vivid reminder of life and death in an eternal cycle. The deeper Caleth ventured, the more he felt the palpable presence of magic. It was as if the forest itself watched him, ancient and wise, whispering secrets through the rustling of leaves. The feeling was disconcerting, yet exhilarating, knowing that every step took him further into a world few had ever seen. The first challenge came unexpectedly. As Caleth was navigating a particularly narrow part of the river, the wind picked up, whistling through the trees with a haunting melody. Suddenly, the wind formed words, echoing around him. "What is born each night and dies each dawn, only to rise anew from the twilight?" Caleth paused, considering the riddle carefully. He understood then that he was not merely passing through nature, but engaging with it. After a moment, he responded, "The answer is the moon." No sooner had he spoken than a gentle gust of wind brushed past him, as if affirming his answer, and the trees slightly parted to reveal a clearer path forward. The forest seemed to grow denser with each challenge, the paths more intricate and the magic stronger. The next trial occurred when Caleth disembarked to stretch his legs along a mossy bank. Here, he heard a soft, sorrowful howl. Following the sound, he found a spectral wolf, its form shimmering with ethereal light, standing guard over a cluster of delicate flowers glowing faintly under the moonlight. The wolf spoke with a voice like the wind through dead leaves. "To take what is mine, you must answer this. I speak without a mouth and hear without ears. I have nobody, but I come alive with wind. What am I?" After a moment of contemplation, Caleth realized the answer and replied, "An echo." At his words, the spectral wolf nodded, its form fading away to grant him passage to the flowers. Carefully, Caleth picked one, its petals cool and luminescent against his skin, a token of his successful trial. With each solved riddle and past challenge, Caleth felt a deeper connection to the forest and its arcane rhythms. He began to understand that these trials were not merely obstacles, but lessons in understanding the delicate balances of nature. The final riddle came as he reached a glade where the trees circled around a clear, still pond, the waters reflecting the starlit sky above. Here, the air was thick with the power of the forest, and the presence of the forest spirits was almost tangible. A voice, deep and resonant, filled the air, echoing from the very earth beneath his feet. What runs but never walks, has a mouth but never talks, has a head but never weeps, has a bed but never sleeps. Caleth stood silently for a long moment, his gaze upon the serene waters before him. Then, with a calm certainty, he answered, "A river." The ground trembled lightly beneath his feet in approval, and the trees around the glade bowed as if in respect. The path ahead cleared, the underbrush retreating, and the trees parting as if by an unseen hand, revealing the route towards the hidden delta. As he walked this newly revealed path, Caleth felt a profound sense of accomplishment and unity with the forest. The fiercest of the forest spirits, ancient beings of wood and leaf, appeared briefly before him. Their forms were both terrifying and beautiful, woven from bark and vine and flower. They offered Caleth their blessing, their voices a chorus of the forest itself, affirming his respect for nature and acknowledging his readiness to face the water spirit. With their blessing, Caleth continued, now not just as a traveler, but as a part of the forest's own story, moving forward with a deeper understanding of the world's natural magic and his place within it. Chapter 4, The Hidden Delta. Upon arriving at the Hidden Delta, Caleth found himself enveloped in an environment that transcended the ordinary. The delta, a lush oasis, was shrouded in ethereal mists and illuminated by a surreal glow emitted from bioluminescent plants and fungi. Their soft blue and green lights flickered like gentle stars fallen to earth, casting a serene luminescence over the landscape. The air was fresh and filled with the soothing sound of flowing water, which seemed to sing a welcoming song just for him. At the center of this mystical delta lay a tranquil pond, its waters clear and vibrant, untouched by any impurity. From this pond, the water flowed out in gentle rivulets, nourishing the lush vegetation and creating a haven for countless birds and small forest creatures. It was here, by this life-giving pond, that the water spirit made its presence known to Caleth. The spirit materialized slowly, emerging from the pond, as if woven from the water itself. It took the form of an entity both majestic and formidable, draped in robes that flowed like liquid, their surface shimmering with the reflective sheen of a calm sea under moonlight. The spirit's eyes were deep pools of wisdom, ageless and penetrating, looking into Caleth with an intensity that seemed to pierce his very soul. "Welcome, Caleth of Elfland," the spirit's voice resonated, melodic and as clear as its waters. "To earn my aid, you must solve a riddle that seeks not just intellect, but the essence of empathy and sacrifice. Listen well. What is the force that drives the sea to kiss the shore, no matter how many times it is sent away?" Caleth pondered the question, sensing the depth of its meaning. he walked slowly along the edge of the pond, watching the water ripple softly under his touch. The answer, he realized, lay not just in the logic of the words, but in the understanding of the natural order and the relationships within it. After a moment of reflection, Caleth spoke, his voice steady and sure. The force is love, an enduring love that nature holds for all its creations, ensuring harmony and balance. Just as the sea loves the shore, so must we love and protect the natural world which sustains us. The water spirit regarded him silently for a moment, its expression unreadable. Then, the waters of the pond stirred, and the air shimmered with a new light. "Well," answered Caleth, "you see beyond the surface, understanding the deeper currents that bind the world." Pleased with his response, the spirit continued, "In recognition of your wisdom and respect for all life, I will form a pact with you. Promise that your people will guard and cherish the water, never taking more than what is needed, and always ensuring its purity. In return, I will restore the flow to your village's spring and safeguard its clarity for generations to come." Caleth bowed deeply, accepting the terms of this sacred pact. "We will honor our part with all our hearts," he pledged. "The waters that sustain us will be cherished and protected as a member of our own community." With the pact sealed, the water spirit bestowed a blessing upon Caleth, touching his forehead with a droplet of water that glowed with a golden light. "This blessing," the spirit explained, "would ensure that Caleth's guidance to his people would be wise, and that the balance between his village and the natural world would remain unbroken." Triumphant and filled with a profound sense of purpose, Caleth returned to his village. His return was met with celebration and reverence as he recounted the tale of his journey and the lessons learned along the way. Under his guidance, the villagers renewed their commitment to live in harmony with nature. They implemented practices to use water sustainably, protect the surrounding forests, and preserve the purity of their natural resources. Thus, the mystery of the vanished water was resolved, not through conquest, but through understanding and respect. The harmony between elfkind and the elemental forces was restored, ensuring that the land of Elfland would flourish for eons, a testament to the bond between its people and the magic that sustained them.